When I think back over the WrestleManias, which always are my favorite ones, I always sort of, you know, group together each year. You know, when I think about, like, the classic years, I always sort of group 1 through 10, and then there's 11 through 13. I go 14 through 18, and then, you know, 19 through about 24, and then that sort of moves them into the new era. But, you know, when I think back about the classic WrestleManias, I always think about WrestleMania 8 being one of my favorite WrestleManias when I was growing up. It sort of, you know, was the last big boom for the WWF before really, you know, starting to backslide into oblivion, I think, pretty much. This was the last real WrestleMania that Hulk Hogan was involved in. He would come back and he would do WrestleMania 9, but he was promoted inside of a tag match, and everybody knows that basically because of the slide that the WWF was on, Vince McMahon tried to catch lightning in a bottle one more time by putting the championship on Hulk Hogan, with him beating Yokozuna in the main event that he wasn't even involved in after, you know, beating Bret Hart. It was supposed to be the big deal of Yokozuna winning the championship, and within a minute, he's no longer a champion anymore. The guy that you've been building up by squashing people on Superstars week after week. Next thing you know, he wins the Royal Rumble as a guy that, you know, was sort of a favorite because of his weight, but still a big surprise when he won that Royal Rumble. Then going on and beating Bret, the real wrestler's wrestler at that time. And even though he was, you know, from Canada, he was the Olympic hero, not the Olympic, but the, so used to Kurt Angle, he was the United States hero. You know, everybody would chant USA, USA when he wrestled against Yoko, sort of, you know, as a boo the Japanese guys, even though he wasn't even Japanese. But, you know, when I think about WrestleMania 8, it was that real last big WrestleMania. You know, they put it in the Hoosier Dome, now known as the RCA Dome. Well, not even known as the RCA Dome anymore. I don't know if they've torn it down, but I know that the Colts have at least moved over to playing in a new place. But if you think about the problems that the WWF had back at WrestleMania 7, they thought that they were going to be able to, you know, have 100,000 people in the LA Sports Coliseum to see WrestleMania. You know, it came down to it months before the show. They had only sold 10,000 tickets. You know, where were these 90,000 fans going to come from under the sort of, you know, there's national security problems. They moved into the LA Sports Arena, a very, very small arena where they only had 16,000 people in it. And, you know, they move it over. They put it in Indianapolis, a less of a travel city for a lot of people. But they're able to put 62,000 people together. The next year, WrestleMania 9 would be held in Las Vegas in a lot of a smaller, stadium. And they only drew 19,000 for that one. And then, of course, from there, they would go to Madison Square Garden, another arena that has, you know, huge historic, you know, history behind it, but you know, another smaller arena. You know, you could definitely see that they are moving down, and this was a big boom in the middle of nowhere for the WWF. You could think that WWF in this year, 1992, was really sort of, at the same time they were hitting on all cylinders, they were sort of backsliding as well. They were still running with the Hulk Hogan red and yellow. Of course, it wouldn't be until 1996 that Hulk Hogan actually turned into a bad guy. But if you go and see what sets up the WrestleMania main event, with it being the Royal Rumble 1992, it comes down to three guys that are involved. There's Sid Justice, Hulk Hogan, and Ric Flair. And basically, you can see Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair battling out in the Rumble. And then at the last second, Sid comes over and eliminates Hulk Hogan, who was supposed to be his buddy at the time. And, the place erupts that we're finally going to see somebody win the championship, and it's not going to be Hulk Hogan. Hulk Hogan was easily one of the favorites in this match. And people were at the point of just not wanting to see Hulk on top anymore, wanting to see something new. Sid Justice had came over from WCW, and it looked like he might be moving into that new Hulk Hogan place. Ric Flair had came over earlier, and he came in with a whole bunch of prestige, of course, that he had been a lifelong, you know, NWA, WCW guy. And basically because of a problem of a falling out with the guy who was in charge of the company, Jim Herd, basically Ric Flair found himself without a job. They came to him, Jim Herd, the Pizza Hut pizza boy, basically got put into this because he was friends with Ted Turner, and basically he thought that they needed to recreate the wheel of Ric Flair. They wanted him to cut his hair, they wanted him to start wearing an earring, they wanted him to start going by the name Spartacus instead of Ric Flair, and saying that they needed Ric Flair to change with the times, show that, you know, it wasn't going to be the good old boy wrestling of the old days. Basically, Rick dragged his feet, and because of this, they fired him. Jim didn't really understand the ways of wrestling was with the NWA, where basically Ric Flair was the NWA champion. To be champion, you had to basically put up $250,000 cash, to be able to carry around the belt. This was the insurance that you basically wouldn't screw over the company. You wouldn't lose the championship and lose how much it costs. Basically, you were sort of buying the belt, or you can say on loan. One of the deals with giving them the $250,000 is they would put the money into a bank account. The bank account would accrue interest, and that would be sort of like when you lost the title, sort of almost like a bonus on the money that they give you your $250,000 cash back, and then they also, on top of that, slide you whatever the bank interest was on top of that. When Rick got fired, they asked for the championship back. Rick asked for the money, and the NWA, WCW didn't have it, so basically Rick kept the championship, and he started showing up on WWE TV. Actually, the belt made its debut with Bobby Heenan on Primetime Wrestling before Rick ever did. Bobby Heenan brought it out and basically said that the real world's champion was coming. And this was a match, basically, that I thought a lot of people had been hyping up. I remember going and reading the magazines, all the wrestling magazines as I was a kid. Basically, my dad and me would walk throughout the store, and the second we got to the front of the store and, we got to the registers, I would just tell them, I'm going to go look at the magazines. And I'd go look at the wrestling magazines, and I'd flip through them. And, you know, once a year they've come out with this dream card of basically what if these two companies came together and put them together. And it was always like Hulk Hogan going up against Ric Flair, Brian Pillman against Randy Savage, you know, just sort of pairing up the bigger names together. Of course, everybody still thinks about like Sting versus The Undertaker, that dream match that everybody has, hoping that we finally see it at WrestleMania. And basically, Hogan versus Flair seemed like he would be just such a moneymaker. You know, Flair was the million time champion for the NWA and WCW. Basically, was that guy that was always on top of that company. Hulk Hogan was the guy that was always on top of the WWF, and we get to see finally who the better wrestler was. Was it, you know, the red, white, and blue all American babyface, or was it the dastardly heel that was going to do anything he had to do to get it done? It seemed like it was so easy when Flair came in, and they were working in the same towns at the same time. Vince was, you know, trying to pop little towns by basically having Hogan versus Flair as a house show main event. And basically these towns that had low attendance figures to begin with, were the figures that put together was when Vince was putting together WrestleMania. He decided not to give us Hogan versus Flair, even though this was a match that was basically put together on television as it was a part of the angles that were going on. They actually filmed the press conference where basically they had all of the number one guys, and they basically were saying who. I think at the time, Jack Tunney was still the president, because I think he was still alive. Jack Tunney got to pick who the number one contender was, and he basically picked Hulk Hogan. Sid Justice felt like he was screwed because he was the follow-up guy in the Royal Rumble. He should have been the number one contender. Rodney Savage was there. Roddy Piper was there. I can't think of any other guys were up there, but basically, you know, everybody cut promos of what they were doing. I'm sure you can scour the WWE Network and find this somewhere along the way. I think I've seen this in the past over on YouTube. It's one of the best things that the WWF in 1990-ish. One of the best, you know, vignette promos, because it looks so real. I mean, everybody reacts the way they reacted if they felt like it was about to go down. Sid Justice and Hulk Hogan were basically torn apart because of this, and they basically decided to go in a different direction, where basically Sid turned on Hogan, and this happened on a Saturday night's main event, where basically they were in a tag team match. I can't remember who that was against at this point, but basically Sid walked out on Hogan when he was getting beat down in the ring, and because of this, Jack Tunney decided that they must, you know, push this match up to WrestleMania, taking the title shot away, where basically Hogan decided that, you know, going after this former friend of his that had turned against him was bigger than going after the championship. Because of this, Ric Flair got moved into a program where he went up against Randy Savage. Now, you know, there's big numbers about this. I always think of WrestleMania 8 as being one of my favorite pay-per-views as I was a kid. When you look back over it, even though I think the Hulk Hogan versus Ric Flair would have been a bigger match, you know, that a lot of people would still be talking about this time. We wouldn't be able to see this until both guys were in WCW. I believe it was in 1994. I can't remember what pay-per-view it was at, but I want to think it was at the Bash of the Beach was the first time that we saw these guys go at it. And I'll have to ask Jim. I know Jim will know, or I can just look it up on Wikipedia one way or another. But, you know, the WWF either is the smartest genius in the world, or they were able to turn chicken salad into chicken shit. When you really look at the card they were able to put up, you know, Hulk Hogan versus Sid Justice as the main event. Honestly, the match had a big appeal. They booked it as Hulk Hogan's last match. They did all the, you know, promos of Hogan saying he was to retire, he was to walk away, he was to go make movies. So this was the match that you had to see because this was going to be it. You know, there's a lot of matches. Owen Hart versus Skinner, Natural Disasters versus Money Inc. These are matches that I don't really remember. You can even say that about the 8-man tag. I got no clue, but all the other matches on here, from Tatanka versus Rick Martel, it's a great wrestling match. Savage versus Flair is a great wrestling match where Ric Flair gets in trouble for blading and basically gets a big fine after that, but the Savage versus Flair is excellent. Hart versus Piper is one of the best matches of both of their careers. Undertaker versus Roberts is really the start of the streak because that's really one of the big matches, of course, with Undertaker taking Jake Roberts out on the floor, giving the Tombstone Piledriver out on the outside. Michaels versus El Matador was a great way to kick off the show. Of course, El Matador being Tito Santana, one of my favorite wrestlers as a kid. I never really caught it until, you know, I got older that I was really a fan of real wrestling. I always thought I was a fan of, like, Hulk Hogan because that's what they told us. But, you know, when you drift towards and you really like seeing these guys, I never really knew what got me. But it was always those matches were the ones that I couldn't get up from and walk away when certain guys were in the ring. Bret Hart, you know, Tito Santana, Rick Martel, just guys that really knew how to wrestle and really get it done right. You know, not only just the sports entertainment side, but the actual wrestling that was in the ring. Now, you got to debate it if whether you think that, you know, Vince threw away a lot of money because he was able to do what he did. And of course, you know, Savage versus Flair went out and they delivered a great WrestleMania classic. Hogan versus Sid, the match isn't that good. You can say a lot of things about this because the main event basically came down to Sid Justice didn't want to do the job for Hogan. Hogan wasn't doing the job for Sid. They decided to do a run and finish where basically Papa Shango, who doesn't fit into this match at all, does a run in, and the Godfather misses his cue where he's supposed to run down there and break up the pinfall. Because he's late, Sid Justice kicks out of the leg drop. There's no three count. There's never an announced winner. They just start playing the Hulk Hogan music after Ultimate Warrior runs down and cleans house. But, you know, what could have been if it would have been Hogan versus Flair that night? Would it have been one of the, you know, the biggest matches of all time that people would still be remembering, the build that goes down to it? I'll always remember Savage versus Flair in the WWF magazine, where basically Savage had to basically read for himself that Ric Flair and Miss Elizabeth were having an affair, where basically Mr. Perfect and Ric Flair went in and they doctored photos of Savage and Elizabeth and sort of, you know, photoshopped. This is like an angle way ahead of their time. I mean, even if they did it these days, you'd have to sort of explain, you know, what was going on. And then it just blew my mind as a kid. I remember they came out with the WrestleMania preview where they had this actual in there and they had the pictures. And I had full-fledged admitted, I thought Miss Elizabeth is a cheater. There's no way these could be doing it. And then basically the next month it came out where Savage and Miss Elizabeth published the photos that were unedited and undoctored, and they were picture-perfect, where both guys were in the same position. They just sort of took this picture and put it on top, and you know, they even picked out clues how, you know, Ric Flair had a WrestleMania 5 VHS, it would be WrestleMania 4 VHS, you know, on the shelf, and there was a Randy Savage picture on the wall, and even though the towels said R and E, you know, basically the R wasn't for Rick, it was for Randy, and it just, you know, I guess it makes sense, but that's always one of those history's mysteries, you know, why it never happened. Did Hogan not want to lose the Flair? Did Flair not want to lose the Hogan? Was Vince not be able to, you know, smooth this thing out and see what went down? But it's always going to be one of those things. Lots of people like to think about the screw job, but I always like to think of why Vince McMahon never did Hulk Hogan versus Ric Flair at WrestleMania. He had both guys under contract for WrestleMania 8, and it seems like it would have been one of the biggest WrestleMania main events that they've ever done.